Hello again, everybody. We are in Unit 6 now. This is Lesson 22. And I'm going to point out something that you'll notice right here at the beginning of this first lesson. You're starting to see the image of a piano keyboard. They're going to be using this. We're going to be using this more frequently. So I want to ask you to go to your Apple Store or your Google Play Store and find a piano keyboard application. Again, you should be able to get a perfectly good free one, which you can just use, which will make the sounds. And the important thing is you can see things. Because I, over the years as a teacher, I never taught a theory class where it was just pure theory, music theory. I always taught what they called keyboard harmony. And that's where you use the piano as an effective means of teaching people harmony, but music theory. And I really think it works well because it's obviously a visual representation of chords and intervals and harmonies and things like that. And it's also a tactile one. In keyboard harmony, the musician is expected to learn how, not so much to play the piano, but how to use the instrument as a musical tool. So to see and play harmony, play those exercises, learn how to play the scales, to use them. Composers are usually required to have the highest training in keyboard because they'll use it so much in their career. But if you don't have a piano at home, and it's not necessarily you get a piano or even an electric keyboard or something like that, this is actually kind of a hybrid grand. This is a digitally sampled grand that Casio put together that I highly recommend it, actually, in connection with Carl Bechstein of Berlin. So I have a concert grand Bechstein, concert grand Hamburgsteinmann, and concert grand Bösendorfer, which is what this is presently set on, inside this instrument. And it has all these wonderful extra settings. But if not that, then just also on my little smartphone, I have a little keyboard that you can actually play dum bum 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 bum, and you can move it so it'll actually play several octaves. And it was free. I never pay for that stuff. All right. But you're going to need one. It'll help you because it's starting to make reference to a keyboard to help show you another way of remembering or learning this information. And then with the ear training, as it progresses from here on, the keyboard will be especially helpful if you can play music, if you can play it yourself to help teach yourself, but also to it'll help with doing the exercises in the ear training where it's not like a test, it's just teaching you, literally training your ear how to do things. So let's start with Unit 6, Lesson 22. What we're looking at now in these next three lessons is another way to, actually we haven't done this before. I think this is new. We have looked at time and tempo and we figured out ways of manipulating that. We've looked at the value of notes, a quarter note, and we put a, or a half note, and we put a dot after it. So we've learned how to stretch out or affect the length, the duration of note values, either with ties or with dots, things like that. Now what we're learning to do is to change the main pitch. So you have an A, and it's still relative to that A, but you want it to be a bit lower or a bit higher than the A. And it's looked at in terms of the foundational note. So now what we're looking at is kind of manipulating the pitch now in a certain way. And we're gonna, again, they like to start apparently on the left side of things, which they think is low volume or low speed. In this case, we're looking at the lower manipulation of the pitch. So this is called a flat. Now, what does it mean if you get a flat? You get a flat in your tire means that it's not up to where it needs to be to actually run well, okay? If you're flat on your back as opposed to up on your feet, you're not, you know, since you're less than where you need to be in terms of your energy. That's not exactly what this means, but we use the word in English, flat, to denote a note which sounds immediately lower than the one that it's named by. So a flat sign And Rudy will put this up on a special and ship it in the page. Looks like a little B, a small case B, but it's a little fancy looking. The flat sign before a note, all right, when you see it written on a liner space, when it's before the note, it lowers the pitch of the note. And on the keyboard, it shows you play the next key to the left, whether black or white. So it's showing you an octave from C to C. Okay, and you've learned that. Is it okay if I do it like this, Rudy?
Yep, that works.
So we've learned it, you know, we use the letters of the alphabet. So we have A, B, but we're going to start with C. C, D, E, F, G. And we know that G, it only goes up to G and then starts again. A, B, C. So we have C to C. Okay? And we're looking at flats now. So in this case, and it won't always be the case, but most of the time it is, that's these black notes, all right? These are these guys. So if you're looking, for example, at D, the next immediate note flat of the D, it's on the left, is that one. Okay, and we call that one then D flat. Okay, here's C, D, E, go to the left, and we got E flat, all right? The stages with black notes, we got F, G flat, okay, then we have A flat, we got a B flat. Let's just worry about the black notes at the moment. So that's what they're showing you. On the keyboard, play the next key to the left, whether black or white. Okay, so it does mention this. So A flat in music, when you apply it to the note, on the space of the line, it means you play the note immediately to the left, whether it's white or black. And remember, that doesn't mean like this G, the immediate note to the left is not this note. No, there's a guy in between you're ignoring. It's this guy. Okay, that's the flat. Now, however, it is possible, what if you have C and you flat it? You're supposed to, the rule is, it's the next note immediately to the left. So it's this one. Okay? Or if you have F, his next note immediately to the left for a flat is this one. Now I'll get to what that is in a little bit, a few lessons, okay? But the flat is the note immediately to the left on a keyboard. And that's how you hear it. Now you see it, okay? So they've demonstrated on there what is a D flat, an E flat, a G flat, A flat, B flat. When speaking of flatted notes, the word flat comes after it. So when you name it, all right, you're gonna say A flat. That's what we call it. Now we're talking about an A? No, we're talking about an A flat, okay? So you put the descriptor after the name of the note, the pitch. Say the pitch first, and then say flat. However, in written music, the flat sign comes before the note. So if you're saying the name of the note, you know, or you're writing it out in prose for some reason, you would say A flat. But when you see it on the line of the space, it's flat A. You put the note first, A, it goes first. And then you put the flat in front of it. And it also helps you remember that the flat is to the left of that note. There's A, let's see, A, flat, okay? But what's important to know is that it's A, which is flat. So you put the note first and then flat it. And Rudy will put some up here so you can see this, plus you have it on your books in page 34. The way you draw one of these flats is a straight line down and then kind of a funky looking B a little bit. Looks a little kind of pretty. The important thing is when a flat sign is attached to a line note, you do that line, it has to be about three lines worth long, but then you close it with a little B circle on the line that is addressing the note that needs to be changed. Okay? Gives you a little exercise here to do exactly what they did there, put flats in front of the notes. Okay? When a flat sign is attached to the space, again, You draw that little line, approximately 3 lines long, okay? And then you close the little B thing in the space before the note that is to be affected, all right? And they give you some little exercises right there. Okay, and then the actual exercises at the bottom. Number one, in the example, write flat signs before each one of these notes, right? And name the notes, right? So you're gonna put the flat to the left of each one of these notes, but then you're gonna say, this is, look, it's, you're in the bass clef, so this is E flat. So you're gonna put E, and then you can put the little B sign after it, or you can write out flat, right? You can also put, when you're writing it out as letters, you can put E and then put the little flat thing after it, okay? But if you're writing the pitch, it's flat E, flat A, flat D, all right? That's the way it looks here, but down here it'll be pitch first, then flat. Write the names of the piano keys in the boxes, okay? So use this example up here. Now this is an important thing. If you've not done this, you're not a little familiar, and it can be very overwhelming when somebody approaches this keyboard, this monster with all these teeth on it. People get really overwhelmed. But don't look at it as a big ocean of white and black teeth, all right? You know that there are only 7 pitches, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then we repeat it, all right? The important thing also to know is you've got all these white keys, and then you have black ones. But look at the black ones. They occur in twos and threes. Okay, and then if you look at it a little bigger, come up, you know, look a little bit more from the angel's perspective, you have a 2 and a 3, and then again, you have a 2 and a 3, and you have 2 and a 3, 2, 3, 2, 3, 2, 3. Okay, the note immediately to the left of the 2-note black group, the note immediately to the left is C. Okay, that's C. This is C. This is C. This is C. All right, it's always C. And so you can have, you can go from this C to this C. And what you need to remember is that what encloses the 2 and the 3 black notes at the top each time is a C. All right, now always remember the C occurs actually just before you begin the 2 notes, 2 black notes, all right? But that'll help you to remember in here when you look at these. Plus, you can use this as a guide for where your C's are. What I would do is go through and at least, it wouldn't hurt, if you want to, name every damn one of these white notes. F, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B. Write it in the white part, okay? That way, what's going to hurt? That's an exercise. But then what they want you to do is, what's that black note? What's that black note? What's that black note? All right, and you're going to put the letter name for that note. All right, and you'll know because it's to the left of a white named note. The first one, for example, this is F, G, A, B, C, white notes. So this note, which is immediately left of the B, is B flat, okay? Number three, write a treble clef and the notes indicated on the staff using half notes. So you're gonna write a treble clef and then you're gonna write a G flat. And you can write it where you want. You can write it on the second line or you can write it on the first space ledger line above the staff, right? But make it a half note and remember all those rules. If it's a half note and it's below the third line, the stem goes up on the right. If it's a half note above the third line, the stem goes down on the left. You're going to have to make sure that's correct. And then put your flat left of the note. Whether, for example, if you do the second line G, you're going to put the head and the stem is going to be on the right. You're still going to have your flat so that the little B part is right next to the note on the second line. And it's going to be left of the note. If you were to place the G up here on the space above the F here, then you're going to write a circle for a head. You're going to write the stem down on the left. You're still going to write the flat, the little B part, showing that that G on the space is what's to be flatted. It's on the left. It's always on the left.
when it's in the music.
Okay. Number four, write a bass clef and the notes indicated on the staff using quarter notes. Okay. So down here, you're going to put in an F bass clef, and then you're going to write quarter notes in each one of those spaces with the heads filled in, the stems on the correct side, but the flat will always be to the left. Okay. That's enough about flats. See you in a moment. Okay, welcome back. We are at Unit 6, Lesson 23, and we're going to be doing continuing manipulating the pitches, but this time we're going up instead of down, and we're going to the right. So the previous lesson we had was in flats, which are always on the left, and it's the note that's immediately to the left of the main pitch. Now we're going to go to the right of the main pitch, and these are called sharps. Rudy will put this thing up on the screen so you can see it real clearly. This is the sharp sign. The sharp sign before a note, again, this is the interesting thing, is that these little messages about manipulating, I may have said something at the beginning that would be a little, interpreted a little bit wrongly, but whenever you use these little symbols to manipulate the pitch, whether it's a flat or a sharp, or even in the next lesson, the other one you're going to learn, they go always before the note. I should say that now instead of to the left or the right. They go before the note, which means you read this information before you see the pitch. We're always reading from left to the right, so it is technically it's always going to be on the left side. But this now is sharps, but it has a different effect on the pitch. The sharp before a note raises the pitch of that note. On the keyboard, it's the next note immediately to the right. Okay? So you remember the lesson we had just before about two black notes, three black notes, and in between is C to C. Now what we're doing is looking at the black notes in terms of their relationship to the note below on the left, to the left of them. So we pick the pitch, C, and we go up to the sharp. C sharp is here. We go to the right. Immediately after the pitch note, C sharp. Here's D sharp, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp. Okay, now the other thing with this white stuff, remember these signs mean the immediate note with flats to the left, with sharps to the right. So if you have an E, then the immediate note to the right is actually this F. Now we're going to talk very soon about what this can mean, but this is E, and this is E sharp. It's also F, but we'll get to that in a moment. B sharp becomes woo, C, all right? Because if you see the B, and then you have the sharp written before it, it means go up to the note immediately to the right, which is here. Okay? I'll explain that very shortly, in two lessons from now, what that's called and how it works, okay? When speaking of sharp notes, the word sharp comes after the letter name. Same thing as with the flats. When you're writing the letter name of the note, then it's C flat or C sharp. But you say the pitch first and then what you do to it. So in this case we're talking about sharps, this is a C sharp. However, again, as with the flat lessons, in written music the sharp sign comes before the note. Okay, I imagine Rudy can see this. You can look on 34 and 35, you can see this. These signs affect the pitch and they're written down to the left of the note. But the flat means that you play the note immediately to the left. The sharp means you play the note immediately to the right, but they're written on the left side of the main pitch, okay? So again, in the way you write these things, I skipped this with the flat. No, I didn't. I showed you. With the sharps, it's the same kind of thing. You write two vertical lines, about three lines long in the staff, and then a slight angle, you cross them. So you go boom, 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 boom. And it looks like this. All right, you can practice some here on the lines and on the spaces. And again, when you make the sign, you go the vertical lines and then the little crosshatch lines, they have to enclose that line or that space of the note that's being adjusted. All right, so you have to visually see that. See the little spot that's open, that the where it hatches across and it encloses it, is on the same line as that note. It's on the same space as that note. Otherwise, it can get confusing. I mean, you know, really quick writing, Beethoven's writing, when I was composing stuff, you just go tick, 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 tick. Well, it's in front of the note, and most musicians realize, well, he wants that note sharp. Yeah, but to keep it clear, especially when the music's printed, and you're sending it out to all kinds of people to read it and everything, it needs to be very clear, right? So the sharp, it's on the same line as the note that it's modifying, as is the flat, whether it's a line or a space, okay? I think the exercises are pretty much the same here. Number one, in the example, write sharp signs before the note and then name them. So you're gonna put sharps to the left of each one of these pitches on the staff, and then you're gonna name them. The first one would be F sharp, C sharp, but up here it would be sharp F, sharp C, okay? You're gonna do the same thing in this exercise two. Go ahead if you need to and write down F, A, B, C, D, E, and so forth, all the way through on the white notes, and then identify the black notes according to the relationship. So here's F, and they want to know what this is. Well, in sharps, this is F sharp, okay? Then we have treble clef here, bass clef here. They want you to use eighth notes here in this one. So write eighth notes, remember, with the little flag on it, in the correct space in the treble clef. And you're going to put a sharp to the left of each one of the notes wherever they occur. Whether the stem is going up or down, doesn't matter. It's all to the left of that pitch. Bass clef, very specifically, they want you to write dotted half notes. That's with the dot just on the right side of each head. It's to increase it by one value, a half of its value. But this is a bass F clef, and put it, but the sharps are always going to be on the left. Okay? That's sharps. Okay, we are back, and with our last symbol that we're using to adjust pitch. This is Unit 6, Lesson 24. Now we have what are called naturals. So we had flats, all right, which lowers the note, one immediate note to the left, or sharps, which raises the note, one immediate note to the right. And the naturals restore the note to its original pitch, all right? So the natural sign before note cancels the previous sharp or flat. On the keyboard, a note after a natural is always the white key, okay? When speaking of natural notes, the word natural comes after. So again, a flat, a sharp, a natural, right? The only time that you really need to specify, this is not written here, but I assume it's not, that the only time you need to specify that it's natural is to make clear to another person that at some point before that, that A was flatted or sharped. And so you're saying, now it's not. Now it's just a natural. But in general, when you talk about the pitch by itself without being adjusted, you say A, right? A is a natural. But you usually use the natural word to differentiate between it having been before flatted or sharped. And now it's canceled and made natural again, okay? And the way that you do it, it's the best thing rather than describing it, is you take a look at it. Birdie will put it up there, but you kind of go chick, chick, and then you finish that part, chick, chick. All right, so each one of the lines is about 2.5, maybe 3-ish lines long on each side. And again, there's the cross hatches, but unlike the sharp, where you have two vertical lines which are the same length and you cross hatch them with either on the line or the space, this one, you actually do one vertical line, cross over to make an L. Then you do an upside L, which attaches to the first line on the left, and it goes down and past it, so it's the same length. And that's a natural sign. But again, what they're going to say here and here is that as you write these things, and these are exercises to practice them, they must appear exactly so that the cross-hatching area is either on the line or the space of the note that you are adjusting. Okay, so these are for the lines, and these are for the spaces. Now, this is a good thing to know. When flat, sharp, or natural signs appear within a musical piece, here finally you're going to learn a good word. These three words are grouped together. They're called accidentals. Accidentals, right? Meaning they're an exception to the rule. Most of the time in the piece of music, you're going to be playing a B. All right, for example, in this piece, it's going to be in a key where the B will be B. But at some point, the composer wants you to play a flat B. So he'll mark that. Because it's not otherwise you would expect whenever you see a B written. Again, it's all shorthand to keep it simple. And when I see a B, it's a B, it's a B, it's a B. But now all of a sudden, no, it's B flat. Okay? And until that's canceled in that measure, it's always going to be a B flat. If it shows up again, he won't write it again. It's an accidental, which means the B in this measure from here to the bar line is going to be a B flat if it appears again. What they're going to say here is, an accidental sign affects the notes written on the same line of space following it for that measure only. Okay, so if you're playing the piece of music and he writes B flat and there happens to be another one in the same measure, he's not going to write B flat a second time because the rule that we understand as musicians, that accidental covers that situation in that measure. The next measure for consideration, the composer might write natural on the B in the next measure. Just remind you, no, now it's normal again, okay? But the rule is, he doesn't have to do that because you should know the B in the next measure. If he's on the very next beat across that bar line, it's a B natural. But usually to make it clear, for any reason to be a doubt, he would put the natural sign. So they're showing you some examples. Here is an F sharp and a G. And then that means that the F afterwards is still understood to be an F sharp. Here's an A flat C. This is an A, which has to be an A flat because this flat controls any A in that measure. All right? And here's E flat, which means the second one's an E flat, but he wants it to change back to the natural, so he has to write the natural within the measure. Okay? Here's an F sharp, which he wants to change to an F natural. Here's an E. But the last thing that you saw, first you saw a sharp, but then it was canceled by the natural, and now here's another F, so it's controlled by the natural. All right? Whoever the last guy was to give the order, that's the order that you follow until the end of the bar. You can have both of them in the same measure, but in this case, the F sharp was canceled by the F natural. You could have just the opposite. You could have an F natural on the first beat, all right, and it would just look like F, because presumably it is F in the piece. But then he'd sharp it, and then you have the E, and then you have this other F. Well, this one would be F sharp, because that was the last command that you had from an accidental. Okay? Here's a rule. A bar line cancels all accidentals in the previous measure, except if a note is tied across the bar line. Okay, that's because you're holding the pitch longer, and we learned that many times you use that tied across the bar line to increase the duration of a note value. So here's the first example. We have a C, C sharp, and D. Bar line, that C is natural again. All right, that's understood. If he's a nice guy, and if it's very complicated, you see some music, sometimes the editor, publisher will have sympathy on you. Sometimes the composer, if he realizes this is pretty dense shit, and I want to make sure they understand, I shouldn't have said that word, maybe, I'm sorry. I would have gotten bleeped out in a video. C sharp, D. He might put, okay, it's a C natural. Just because it's a lot of information going on, they might miss it. But the rule is, at the bar line, if we go back to the original rules, whatever they were, the accidentals lose their value. Now here's one with a tie. Here's an A, and he has a B flat, which he's added to the score, because that's an accidental. And it's tied over to a B in the next measure, but it's still the same note, not being rearticulated because it's a tie, so it remains B flat. But then he doesn't want that anymore, so he changes the note, he cancels the flat, and writes a natural cipher. Okay? It's not really that hard. Basically, the natural sign is restoring the pitch to its white key pitch, regardless of the sharp or flat that was written before. All right? In the example, right, natural signs before each note, then name the notes, okay? It's the same thing you did with the flats and sharps. They're all whole notes here, but just remember, again, like the flats and the sharps, accidentals, I can say that now as a group, always go on the left of the note, period. There's never an exception for that. Well, that's not true. There are, but you're not going to run into that probably for a long, long time. Most of the time, the accidentals are always on the left of the note. All right, and then we have write the names of the notes on the lines below the staff. Okay, so there's a piece of music here. I can play it for you in the Zoom class. And what you need, dum dum da 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 dum dum da. I sing it, dum dum da 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 dum dum da dum. It's a famous circus song, right? You just have to say C, B, A sharp, B, A sharp, A natural. Okay, just make sure you write that all out. And that is your accidentals. Finishing with lesson 24 with the naturals. Welcome back, everybody. This is Unit 6, Lesson 25. And this is introducing a concept we're going to need to use in the whole next book, because you'll find as you turn your pages, we'll add the ear training time and the review of lessons of Unit 6. But we have finished the first book after that. So all of these words and terms and symbols are things that hopefully you've been introducing into your knowledge set, right? And this is a good thing to look at. I would go through and check the things off if you understand what they are, and then review things until you can get where you can check everything. And this is a good way of saying, yep, I know what all that stuff is. This exercise that we're, this lesson that we're doing here, number 25, begins to apply to the beginning of the next book. But it's also reviewing what you've been doing with the accidentals. They use the accidentals as a means of beginning to teach you of spatial relationships on the keyboard between notes. Now, it's not just visually spatial, it's also auditory. So, because our music, Western music, with some contemporary exceptions, the smallest difference in pitches we have are what we call a half step, right? That's the difference that we had when we had C to C sharp, D to D sharp, E, and again going back down, E now that we go back down, we're going flats, E flat, D, D flat, C. This is the smallest interval that we use in traditional Western music. Contemporary composers and people writing from different world styles do use smaller intervals. They actually have vibrations that are smaller than that. Folk music, for example, in Bartok, Béla Bartok was a great Hungarian composer who was really famous for being one of the first ethnomusicologists. He and Dohnányi went around Hungary into the villages with a record player and ground records. With people singing their old folk songs, and they were collecting the folk songs. And what they noticed was these people weren't singing out of tune. They were singing in microtones. So there are quarter steps and anything down, I think, at least to eighths. And I had a Egyptian friend, Ashraf, who's a professional opera singer, wonderful singer, wonderful musician. But he also, his ear is trained for his own music, the Arabic music, which uses a scale which goes down to an eighth. So they have, let's see, what would it be? Three or four more notes anyway. Between our half step, those two pitches, they have three or more pitches that they actually identify and use for their music, for ornamental purposes. But the important thing is that the smallest step that we're going to be identifying and working with in this book, in traditional Western harmony and theory, is a half step, all right? the distance from any key on the keyboard to the very next key above or below, whether black or white. So it's like with the sharp going up to the right, the flat going down to the left. The very next key above or below is what we call a half step. Okay? So I'm going to play that for you. The half steps in a full scale between C to C. All right, we start with C. Each one of these notes, one after the other, immediately, as we're going up the scale, so immediately to the right of each other, whether it's black or white, those are half steps. We designate that with an H, right, meaning half step. Now, again, you know, you have half notes, and if you put two half notes together, you get a whole note, okay? Now, just did you hear what I said? You put two half steps together, and you get a whole step, right? Obviously. The distance from any key to two keys above or below is a whole step, okay? And that's because you're combining two half steps. So instead of this, I just go like this, okay? Now, if I'm going to play a whole step all the way from C to C, it's going to sound a little different, because what you're going to learn a little bit later in the next book is that the major scale is a combination of whole steps and half steps. So C major is, okay, but for this exercise right now, if I do whole steps, and remember what it amounts to, it's either, you look at it as either two keys above or below from the one you start on, or it's a key in between two keys, all right? Or it's just, look at it as two half steps put together to make that much space. But if I play whole steps, I'm gonna go from here. There's the first whole step, whole step, whole step, whole step, whole step, whole step. This is what's called a whole step scale. Debussy was famous for having experimented with that in his music, and he plays music which is written on a whole step scale. Verses, traditional. Okay. So we have half steps and whole steps. Now, you might have noticed that when you were using flats, and for example, you were on G. When you're doing it, we're going to flat G, you're going to go down to that note, remember? The flat is the very next note immediately to the left of the pitch. So this is G flat. But look at that note. Look at it. It's also a half step above F, right? So if you're looking at sharps, then this note is F. That's F. And if you sharp it, you have to play the note immediately to the right, which is this one. Which means this note actually functions as two notes at the same time. It's both G flat, and it's also F sharp. We have a word for that. The key a half step up from C is C sharp. This key is also a half step down from D, and is also known as D flat. Many notes sound the same. That's the important part. It's like, what do we have? Homonyms, antonyms, and synonyms. Homonyms are the ones that sound the same. Well, I got a really good joke for you. My ex-wife, Robin, her mom grew up, her father, Robin's grandfather, was a rear admiral in the Coast Guard. Very active in the Second World War thereafter. He was an engineer from MIT, but he served a long time. I mean, a real career life as a rear admiral. So they moved around a lot, especially when he was younger and, you know, be assigned to different ships and different responsibilities. Well, they had been living out in Oakland for a while, And then she was about 12 years old, Robin's mother, Joan. They had to go and be based in the Gulf of Mexico, and so she was in school in New Orleans. And she went to school the very first day, and there's an interesting little story that's good about this, that she was sitting there, and the family as a whole, they were New Englanders. They were originally from New Haven. And, you know, Yankees, you know, speaking, you know, good English. Sorry for people. But she was in New Orleans, all right? Very first day in the class, the woman's calling attendance. And, of course, Joan's a new student, very first day in the class, so her name's last. So she's kind of, you know, looking through her materials, her book and stuff, and then taking attendance. And everybody's, and people are going, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am, yes, I'm here, and everything like that. And finally, she calls Joan's name, Joan Strickler? And she answers, she says, yes. And everybody just gets super quiet. And the teacher lowers her glasses on her nose. Joan Strickler! Yes, she answers. She looks here and she says, you must be the new girl, the Yankee from up north. And she said, yes. She says, well, I'm glad to meet you, darling. But she was pissed off because she didn't say, yes, ma'am, right? Well, then the very first lesson they have that morning is the teacher goes, now, class, today I'm going to teach you. We've been learning about words, and now these are words. We have special words called homonyms, homonyms. And homonym means words that sound the same, but they got different meanings. She said, now, for example, she said, when you come in the class in the morning, this is one of the things you might say to me. And she writes up M-O-R-N-I-N-G. And she said, this is something that you might write to me. Now, there's another word that sounds just like this word, but it's spelled different. Anybody know what that is? Nobody answers. So Joan is saying, well, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, because she says, well, I got a clue for you. She says, now, it's something that happens when you go to a funeral, when somebody dies, like a grandparent dies, or something like that. And so she writes up, so Joan is saying, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, good morning and your morning. But the teacher writes up, M-O-A-N-I-N-G. She says, so you see, class, when you come in the morning, you go, good morning, Miss Jones, good morning. And when you go to the funeral, you be moaning because you upset because the person died. And that's a homonym. And Joan went home that day. She said, Mom, we moved to hell. So, in a way, that's the kind of little confusion we got here with our notes. Many notes sound the same, but they're written differently. And these notes are called enharmonic notes. Enharmonic notes. Right, the in part comes from Greek, I think, which means the same. All right, so it serves two functions, depending if you're going up in sharps or you're going down in flats. Now, similarly, with the white notes, this is a good one. These two guys here. E is E, and F is F. Okay? From a flat perspective, E becomes F flat. Okay? And from a sharp perspective, E sharp is F natural, okay? Those two white guys. And the same thing with C and B. C flat, if you flat, it has to go down, and the very next note is the B, the white note. And similarly, if you're on B and you're gonna go sharp, B sharp is this note, which sounds like C natural. So they can also have enharmonic qualities. And that's what they're showing you on this little thing right here, okay? So we have half steps, the immediate notes left to right of each other, and then whole steps, which are either two of those half steps combined, or two notes with one in between, or you just simply go two notes, two keys, above or below. I wouldn't do that one so much. I either do it half steps combined together to make one whole step, or you think of two keys with one key in between. That's a whole step. I don't think it's a big thing together, but this is a crucial thing to learn, people, because in the next book, we're going to start to introduce scales, which is our collections of whole steps and half steps. And then beyond that, we're going to start to introduce what are called intervals, where you put more than one note together at the same time. Those have certain names, but the way that you identify them again is by the number of whole steps and half steps in between them, which is also the way you build the scales. So this is a crucial foundational consideration. And then when you get to the idea, which we haven't quite yet, of keys. Keys in terms of G major or C major or E flat major, they sound differently and they have different combinations of sharps and flats in them. You'll need to look at this sometime, because sometimes those notes will sometimes be sharp names and sometimes they'll be flat names. Exercises for this one. The enharmonic note for F flat is blah, 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 okay? Number two, write the two indicated enharmonic notes on the staff and name the notes in the spaces below, and then they want you to write a particular thing each time, all right? Write the indicated notes on the staff and the name of the note in the spaces below. If there are enharmonic notes, write both. It tells you what to write and how to put in each one. And then these are name the notes and indicate whether the distance between each pair of notes is a whole step, they give you the first one, or half step. You may want to, you can count these on the lines and spaces if you want to, but you can also use your keyboard. Use your keyboard app, or use this example to find these notes and look and see if it's a whole step, meaning there's one extra note in the middle of them, or if they're immediately next to each other. And that is unit 6. And we have completed, I'll see you at the Zoom class after you've completed lesson 6. It's a really great crossword puzzle at the end of this whole book. And as I said, here's your glossary with all the terms and symbols that you will have hopefully begin to put in your mind so far as a means of referring back to what you should know at that point. And then after that, we're going to launch into book 2. So I will see you again the next time. Take care of yourself. Stay healthy. Bye-bye.